wanted actually some guidance about our voting system. There have been requests by various people who wanted to use the basic engine for tasks which are widely different from what we use it for. And even though I say so myself, Devotee is fairly good at running Debian votes and DPL elections. Most of the results, things that we see, are already automated. There are progress reports. And it's a fairly open election and voting process. So I can either go through a whole bunch of talk about what Devotee is, where it came from, and how it is currently, or we can jump to the meat of the walk and talk about where you guys want to take it. History. Alright. We used to have a secretary called Daryl Benham, who ran the votes pre-2000. And around 2000, he kind of disappeared. Like, literally disappeared. Whole chunks of money, because we didn't have SPI back then. And he was back.
He was actually a treasurer at one point. He was a problem for SPI too.
Oh, okay. So there was bank records, etc. They all went. Ian Jackson stepped in 2001 and asked Raoul Miller to run the board because there was no secretary to run the DPL. Raoul ran the board, forgot that DPL elections votes are supposed to be secret, and so that's the only DPL election for which we have fully publicized votes from everybody. Well, he was not used to running it. He was called upon to run the vote. He had to learn the system.
When was that?
I think 2001, as far as I remember. And it was the system as it was then had been created for one giant shed. It was running .forward. The mail would come in. It would open a database, plain text file database, no locking. It would go through, do the parse the GPG signature, make sure it was okay, parse the contents, make sure what the vote was, figure out what the votes would be, and write the database back. No locking, remember. So if another vote came in at the same time, you had problems. And this whole thing, if there was ever anything wrong with LDAP, then that vote was lost, because there were no records kept. Either it went through and you wrote the DP or it didn't. It scared the hell out of me. Raoul at least put in some database locking. So now you wouldn't, but still, if something LDAP was down, you would lose all the votes that came in. So I was tapped in 2002 to see if I would become project secretary. I don't know, in a moment of weakness, I agreed. But then I asked Raoul what we had to do to run the vote, and there were this giant stretch. No way am I going to take responsibility for something like that. So the Devotee was actually written, the first draft, during the DPL election. When the election started, all I had was something that would take the mail and store it in a folder. The rest of the Devotee was written while the election was being run. The goals that I had were, it should be idempotent. That means if you got votes coming in, you rerun the thing, you should get the same results. So every action you take is idempotent. Second, the first thing you do is you save all the data. No matter what happens to the Devotee, even if something crashes in the middle, you should not lose any data at any intermediate stage. And the third thing was to make it not scary to me. So it had to be each stage. Ideally, should be independent, separate scripts, stuff that I can understand at one go. I kind of slipped a little bit on that one. But I was told by various people, AJ and Bidet and everybody, they told me, just fix the whole system, don't rewrite it from scratch. AJ was kind enough to tell me that I shouldn't be doing this because writing mail handling systems, especially those that handle GPG, are not easy. And he sort of wanted to save me grief because not everybody can write such systems, you know. Otherwise, everybody would have. I'm stubborn as well as stupid, so I decided to do it. Devotee divides the current implementation, divides the task of doing the board in, I think, about 9 stages. The first stage runs out of dot forward. All it does is it takes the mail, puts it in a spool directory with blocking. And it increments, so it has, it's kind of like mail DIR, except that I wrote my own implementation because I didn't know very many mail DIR implementations out there that I trusted. And I had 24 hours before the board was supposed to start. So I was kind of under time constraint, so that I can write this in code, I can use flop, I can implement a number, I can do this. So that's stage one. You save the mail. Nobody ever touches anything in that directory. None of the rest of the directory. Stage two copies any mail that has not already been copied from the spool directory to the working directory. So that spool directory is always same timestamp, whatever it was. The working directory is where everybody is. So apart from the spooling, every other devotee script runs in sequence out of prompt. Each one of them logs the top level directory. So at any given time, only one of the other devotee scripts will be running. The spooler runs asynchronously. Copying, the next step is mind handling. You need to separate out the body and base 64 decoding or whatever. Parallel to this, there's the GPG thing where there people sometimes just do a dot, ASCII armor encoded plain text file, just shove it in and send it. So we do that GPG decoding there. Sometimes they also have mailers are funny. Sometimes when you have a mime, GPG mime, PGP mime, encoded mail, you have two parts. One is the message, if you've not encrypted it, the message and the signature. Some mailers go and helpfully encode this afterwards. Some mailers don't encode this. There's also the line ending. The RFC said that all the line endings should be /r/n. Evolution, for example, doesn't care about that. It just gives you /n or whatever was going on. It doesn't decode. So a lot of care has to be taken that you cater to all these various forms of encoded and encrypted messages that come to you, so that otherwise people scream that, hey, it works for me, I sent it to myself too and I could decode it, why can't you? Alright, so now we have GPG decoded, we have done the mind separation, we've got the board sitting in a nice clean format. If the GPG stuff it succeeds, then you go to LDAP, check to see whether the fingerprint is same. Then you parse the vote, tally it. At any stage, if there is any problem, it goes through a puts a message in the log directory. All of this is being done in subdirectories of a top voting directory. So every script reads from rum directory, writes to the next directory, and so on. So we are chaining scripts. And their input and output are changed from going from there. So read from one directory and write to the other. Then we, whether if the board succeeded, then you, whether it was secret or not, you do the, presumably all of us have voted and we know what devotee sends back. If you have ever made a mistake, you know what devotee sends back as a nap. So these are steps that happen whether you send a call, either a nap or a nap. And all this is recorded in the log directory. Thing is, if at any step things fail, like if you go to GPG, if it was not signed, then the GPG authentication step fails, a file is dropped in the log directory, and from that point on, everybody else will ignore this message. if the LDAP fails, you will have GPT. If you run GPT again, you will see that the output directory already contains something. Yes, no, usually instead of yes, it contains your fingerprint. So if the output file already exists, it doesn't do it again. So it is, doesn't do any more calculations than it has to.
Is it based on make files?
It's based on which files?
Make files?
No. I just do it out of run. Could do it. You could run the same thing from make, but it is a sequence. I have got something called DBT cron, which is what I just feed to the it is cron because now I have got a mostly automated method of setting up a new board. I go run the script, it sets up a cron job, it sets up when the board starts using that, sets up when the board finishes using that, and I'm working on something that will send off a signed message to Debian. Actually, I did do it. There's a signed message to Debian board as soon as the results are there. So, the human effort is mostly in making sure that the candidate or the option names are correct. So you have to configure devotee. And from that point on, it mostly is you just let it run and it starts and stops the word on its own. The problem with the current process is, as I said, it is all based on files, subdirectories. And each script reads from the output directory of the previous script and writes into the input directory of the next script. So it is not easy right now to say, let's not do GPG checking, let's just do LDAP, or just forget LDAP and we do GPG, or to insert another authentication method. So it works, but it's kind of packaged. And I apologize for that. I wouldn't have done this if I wasn't under the gun of having people tell me that I had 3 weeks to write this all this stuff in, because that's how long voting lasts. So this I would like to change this, because there have been various people who asked me. They want to use this mechanism, they want to use parts of this. For example, if you're doing the web-based voting, you don't need the mime handler front end. If you're doing web-based voting, you already have a HT access password checking. You don't really need GPG or LDAP checking. SPI probably doesn't need the first 3 steps. No mime, no GPG, no LDAP. Authentication has been taken care of. But the rest would be nice to have a standard method. Currently, the only voting things I have are our Debian's variation of ControlSave. But there are various kinds of voting algorithms out there. You know, first past the post, regular ControlSave, there are all kinds of. SPI also doesn't use the same thing that Debian does.
And it being regular ControlSave,
yeah. So if I could plug in, so it seems to me, now that I have time to read and think about design as opposed to, oh my god, what will I do if I can't get it done in 3 weeks? It seems like this is a blackboard pattern. You define, every board that comes in is a job that is placed on the blackboard. Every job has a certain requirement. The default requirements are stated in priority, that whether you need authentication or not, which set of authentication methods need to be applied. What kind of processing needs to be done for the vote itself, whether you want to say or more than one, you could have multiple parallel results. Communication back to the people who voted, you know, whether your vote succeeded or didn't succeed, secret ballot, non-secret ballot. All of these can be made to be tasks that, so the blackboard pattern for people who are not familiar with looking at professionals. Blackboard pattern is where there are processors that can process jobs. Jobs are placed on the blackboard. So like a human, when you go look at the blackboard, find something that you can do, you take the job off the blackboard. You go off, you do whatever the job needs to be done that you can do it. Then you come back and you place the job back on the blackboard. This way, the blackboard pattern can got all kinds of, it's well enough defined that it will be easy enough to code. And it will also be flexible enough that we can say that throw away bits and pieces. So if you think of this as a plug in a modular framework where you can plug in various things. So you can say plug in various authentication tools. You can plug in various communication tools. There's somebody who wanted me to instead of sending mail back. Can't you, yes, I am on AOL, which is quite interesting. But I told them that no, for Debian, I don't think I'm quite ready to support AOL instant messaging when you send your mail. It won't work. But it is not a bad request. I would like to be able to support other messaging protocols.
Jabber.
Put in a Jabber module, and why can't you send your vote in via Jabber? Hey, it's the XML protocol. There are XML signature protocols out there that you can encrypt your Jabber message. All I need is a way to be able to read your Jabber message and say, okay, this is a valid vote and it was signed by the right key.
So right now you have 7 messages, right? One message goes to one directory, next script, then reset the directory. See that there's no output, the output then
remains. Right. And any time you want to redo, you just remove everything from every other directory except the original spool directory. And then you can rerun the vote again. Usually, when I do that, and I have done that when I made changes in several things, I just turn off the NAP and ACT so you don't get multiple notices for the same thing just because I'm rerunning the vote. But not flexible.
Would it be possible to serve the actual change versus request if you could tell the script, hey script, I want you to run the first script directory, well, it doesn't matter, but this is your input directory, that's your output directory.
There is no code in the OTN to do that. It's not hard to write it, but then configuration becomes an issue, then I would have to be able to configure each script. So it, right now I have one common configuration file for the OTN. And there's lots of people.
So I have the idea of init scripts, you might want to run many different init scripts, but they need to be in a certain order, so people usually prefix them with numbers. So what you could do is you could prefix the subdirectories of the working directory with numbers, and when a script, so your method name would run them in order of number, and the output of a given script would go to the directory of the next number.
So you're talking about a level of indirection. Right now, what the directory name is hard-coded.
Yeah.
And instead of that, you just say that your script number one, so you read from directory number zero and write to directory number two.
You don't even need to tell your script number one. You can just have a directory of scripts in the directory of siblings to the scripts. Isn't that familiar?
They have the same name, the file names are the same. So it is message number XXXX dot something.
It's still a copy of the message just being passed through.
Well, no, the file name is the same. The contents can be totally. For example, if you look at the
text. I wonder if there's any redundancies here where there's certain things in between.
There are events, there are contents.
But you can just see I cannot imagine some use cases where you do not have serialized processing. I mean, you can imagine having a vote where you could vote by name, or by web, or by job, or whatever. So you would have one sequence of.
That's right.
And I'm not sure that storing the. It works. Storing the data in files works. Basically, what we have here is a state machine. Currently has just one string of linear operations,
uh-huh.
But we can envision either multiple inputs for multiple voting protocols, or maybe even parallel.
There are some parts that can be done in fact. There is the point being raised here was there are the dependencies. For example, in order to do the LDAP check.
To that.
Okay.
And I was thinking that it's a problem that could be resolved by chain of records.
Okay.
Using a database could work. It will also provide you with transactions.
There are slight problems. Running a database on master would be hard. A and database, a remote database will bring new problems. Right now, everything is that simple. I can remove files, I can get things to work again.
There are extremely simple databases.
But the thing is you could just have a more complex structure, even still dealing with files.
Sure,
definitely. It was just an idea.
I know, but now, I can't use BI anymore.
But you could still have multiple paths feeding in so that two scripts have the same output work.
Well, actually, I would rather not go into implementation details. I'm going to rewrite DevOT. I'm going to rewrite it in Ruby because I need to learn their language.
We all need to learn Ruby too.
Well, no, right now, what we I need to, look, the blackboard pattern will handle everything you're talking about. And I want to stick at the level of algorithms and patterns at the moment because we can get lost in the implementation details and run out of them. I'm hungry. I don't want to stay beyond the 8 o'clock dinner starting time.
Can you just make it configurable by a shell script, which would list the backends in the right order?
We could, but
and if everybody
you're looking again now, there are various ways of doing this. We can go to a database. We can do more complicated data structures on the file system. A file system is, after all, a database of sorts. But what I need more than that. The implementation details we can always discuss over mailing list. What I want right now in this BOF is a brainstorming session. The idea that you said that the same vote can have multiple means of sending in votes. Now that was, this is a new idea that has devotee doesn't even consider so far. But so how would we handle that in the Blackboard pattern? When a new job is injected onto the Blackboard, its requirements come up. So the processing, the input processing that is done for, if it came in via email, you have to do MIME processing. Okay. If it came in via Jabber, you have to do some kind of XSLT stuff to it in order to grab the raw message that GPG, etc. can then work on. And similarly, on the web, you can say they bypassed the whole checking thing because the web CGI bin already does some authentication.
My idea was something like the GStream framework. We actually construct pipelines, which can be diverted or split into two.
Okay.
And each module has an input format, which needs to be read. You don't feed Java messages into the MIME process.
Okay.
So you have validation and specification of the output format. And you can only put modules that fit.
That makes a lot of sense.
Well, these are two different patterns. What he's talking about is pipelines. But there, the processing has been set in priority. Okay? You cannot change in. So the flexibility of the system is reduced by using the pipeline pattern as opposed to using the blackboard pattern. Because the blackboard pattern, there is no preset pipeline. But if we can do everything that the pipeline pattern does using the blackboard pattern, because each job has a set of requirements. Each requirement can have prerequisites, and therefore there are dependencies between requirements. Each processing unit comes in, looks at a job, and sees, I have a certain capability, and the job has a certain need. I also need to have, for my capability, there is a prerequisite. If the job has the prerequisite processing has already been done, I can take the job and I can do it. This exploits any parallelism that is in the system. Because each processor comes in, I can say that these are the subset of jobs that are on the blackboard that I can work on. It doesn't really, so you don't really have to, so that means you can add a new processing unit and a job with a new requirement anytime, without having to ever change any bit of code. Because your pipelines are being derived dynamically based on the requirements of the job and the processes that are present. So you can plug in more processing units and every task, even calculating results or sending things back is a processing unit. I can plug in a new authentication mechanism or a communication mechanism and the job comes in which has the requirement will automatically be met. I don't have to ever set any pipeline. The advantage of this is, if this is a framework which can create its own dynamic pipeline, then I can give to people who can use this system to do whatever they want. So it can be used beyond devotee. So there is, I did consider the pipeline pattern, but then I decided that the blackboard one was better, because then you can remove processing units and you don't have to construct pipelines a priori.
It seems like it's not even specific to voting. It seems like it's a general blackboard pattern framework which you could then apply in devotee.
That's right. What I want is, what do you guys want to use this for? What kind of processing units do I need to implement at the first go beyond what I already have?
But I mean, one of the things to get to that point was I was looking at was trying to be able to set up for this much more quickly than you can currently.
Okay.
And so that, for example, one of the things I was looking at is the ability of arbitrary people to say, hey, I want to run a vote. These are the options that I want. I want people who have a GPG key that's set up by the trust, people who are the strongly connected set, any male, or people who are in this arbitrary creator, getting
or anybody who can get through PAM on my machine.
Right. I mean, anything you can do to separate people. And then make a vote. Somebody can do it on platform or something, say, hey, run the vote, start time here, end time here, mail results to wherever, run it. And so, for example, if you've got a small organization and you want to run a vote, it makes it easy. You can set an option for the quickly tell it to run. Everybody can send mails.
Okay, this is cool. Essentially, we're talking about if you have a modular voting framework, then you pick and choose what your modules are available. You pick your input modules, you pick your authentication modules, you pick your communication modules, how you send mail back, and you pick your result calculating module. And then you pick what, how the results are published, and all this can be done on the web. So what are the other processing models for Jabber? Was one web is CGI which is built by other.
Command line on a shared multi-user system. Like if it's say an organization like I don't know, if you use an old example of BBS or just a shared server by a separate organization of people, if they all log into the server and run a command locally on a system.
That can be extended to just like the ability to SSH to a vote machine for the sole purpose of running a vote script.
Yeah.
Something that injects your vote. Actually, I could provide it in the current DVD, I just need to copy this. Does anybody have a piece of paper? I forgot to. I need to note these things down.
And with either the local login scenario or the SSH to a special account thing, in either case, the authentication is already taken care of.
Yeah, but SSH to a local account, that is sure.
It should be the person who is running the vote ought to decide whether you still need GPG or authentication or not.
If you can log into master, then you're allowed to.
If you can log into master and are in UPID Debian, I don't know if there's any other accounts on master possible. Maybe a local admin at the site.
There are non-human role accounts.
There you go. So if you're into helps Debian,
yes. So that we probably
we have a local admin
or a local Apache.
Yes. Triple W data votes for Manoj for EPL. I think you need to do a good job of representing web servers everywhere.
This will, if you can release the OTA framework like this, anybody can write up their own modules. So that takes me out of the loop, so I don't have to work so hard.
Right.
However, that does mean you have to write a lot more documentation so that people can write Rust.
Hey, people tell me that Ruby doesn't need documentation.
Okay.
Yes, people to learn
Ruby. It's a nice language.
That's someone else's problem.
Well, you know, if you do it right, you can even make it language agnostic, even if the modules and framework you write are in Ruby, because
the devotee, if you document the design well enough, and we did it
first
of all,
the interface in the backend is documented there.
Yeah.
Also, like, all the scripts.
No, I'm not really sure how. Okay. I'm not really sure I can design. I can commit to designing a interface protocol that is language agnostic. Writing such a framework is hard work.
Would it just be file-based? I mean, presumably you want to have like a paper trail on the disk for everything that is done, so you probably want to stick with plain files like you have now, right?
It might be a reasonable case for XML, I don't know.
Yeah,
I don't like XML either.
Speed then becomes an issue.
So the problem with the current scheme is that the order of scripts is hard coded.
Exactly. And there are various ways you can solve that. The problem actually is that I want to move to a general solution. I want to move to a black hole pattern so that I have received requests from a co-op, a farmers co-op in France, who want to do voting. And they want to use Control-C because we're a Frenchman.
What I would do was to stick with the current scheme of working directories and modify the workers so that they accept input and output directly as an argument and make the whole thing configurable via a shell script that says right from here, read from here, right to there, and this will allow you to set up the pipeline. This will also allow you to have several input methods, so we have just two workers writing to the same directory.
Okay,
sounds pretty natural. The hard thing about it that it requires people to know what the workers are doing. But
it might become too hard. If I'm going to I've been asked to package devotee. If I package devotee, you know the kind of people under being used. They would want to use it for their local.
Yeah, maybe there could be some standard setup that was already ready. And
standard.
I would suggest also that I like the idea of the Blackboard framework because it is even more general than voting and could be used for other things too, even media. I would recommend that you then give the name devotee to your set of voting modules for this framework, which would itself be more general.
Oh, you want me to separate out the framework and packages separately, and devotee is just one user of the framework?
Well, I think that actually is what you're proposing, whether you separate it out or not. That is, the framework itself has no dependency on the notion of voting.
That is true.
But it would probably be pretty specific to the idea of storing jobs as flat files and having files.
But that's still we're not wedded to that. That's why I don't want to implement it. Right now, that's the way I do it, and I'll probably stick with it. But there's no reason if we could change the module so that the messages go through and what's the Ruby editor called? There's a special editor that the Ruby folks have been trying to get me to use instead of Emacs. But that is based on something. It's a plugin. It's not a Blackboard backend, but they have plugins. Internal storage, and so we can borrow that framework, and all the modules then write to what looks like a pseudo file system inside it, but it is sorted in various ways. So we can change our storage. We are not wedded to the files.
I definitely think that the storage system you use should, like the file format itself, should not be tied to any specific language. For example, to give an example that obviously won't use. It should not be Java serialized objects. And, you know, whether it's flat file with a documented format or XML or something else,
the framework shouldn't specify what's your file format anyway. Because devotee would like to still use email. For the email of impotent. And then the intermediate forms, I already have all we need is Debian's login ID or fingerprint and what the vote was.
For each job on the blackboard, I think it would have two parts. You'd have the data blob, which would be in some specific format specific to what stage the job is at. And then you'd also have metadata about what stage the job is at. And that would maybe be in a second file. And the second file would be in a well-defined format.
Right. And I think the blackboard pattern has some kind of best practices format of how you specify the metadata. Yeah. Been a while since I've read it.
But that seems like it would be reasonably portable and easy to document.
Hey, Scooby.
And it seems like, and it wouldn't even be language specific. And I mean, anybody could parse some simple format and do whatever with the data. And I mean, and the framework itself would be very lightweight.
Propose maybe the framework.
Wouldn't have to deal much with that.
Okay.
Propose maybe the framework talk.
I was thinking of Temple of Doom, but
well, it's a blackboard pattern.
Actually makes sense, yeah.
But back to this, I mean, one of the main reasons that I personally it's confusing at first time you managed to set that for all different
drivers. Yeah, that's why I'm now creating scripts so that people like you can come in and just run the damn thing and see what it does.
Right.
And this new thing should be the blackboard should be even easier to configure than what I have now, because that's going to be
mainly matter of defining which modules you want to use.
And some way of feeding data to the input modules that you've selected.
Right.
Yeah. Well,
a few global parameters about
I don't know what they would be at the moment.
Where to get the key ring and or how to log into LDAP.
Well, that would be specific to each module.
That would be part of the config of module.
Right. But you just have like list of modules and then just a few variables.
And maybe some place where the modules know config directly where the modules know to look for.
And they have their own config files.
Yeah.
I mean, you don't even need to have anywhere a method or list of modules. You just need to make sure that before you start feeding data into it, you have all the necessary module programs running. I was thinking that they could even monitor the directory for, or monitor the blackboard for new entries, whether it's
The modules will.
Yeah, and it could be with McFam or whatever, and it could just notice when there's something there and deal with it. So if you just have all the components ready before, and all of them running, before you have any data being fed into it, then it'll just all handle it.
There will be one thing that will be necessary for this, which will be the prerequisites. For example, currently, the way that LDAP works is it looks at the fingerprint of the person who has signed the vote. It uses that fingerprint to query the LDAP database to make sure that they are in the right process.
So that shows up in that prerequisite list would show up in the metadata for each job.
For each job, but there might be some other way of using LDAP. So there's an LDAP module. Based on this configuration, it queries the LDAP in some fashion. I can say that just take the user with the name in the from header, see if they belong in my database. Forget about GPG, we don't have a GPG key there. So now, even though you have the LDAP module, what it is using as input has changed. And that is configuration of the LDAP module. So the dependencies for the LDAP module might change from vote to vote, depending on whether you want to change GPG into LDAP or not. So this metadata about which modules are dependent on what.
I didn't mean the metadata would have that. The metadata would just have like prerequisites and it would have keywords of what has been satisfied. Mm-hmm. But which ones a particular module would require in order to continue, as opposed to just ignoring a message for the present, that's really up to the individual module, I assume.
Well, say suppose a new
module could create a configuration file and then it would decide dynamically which prerequisites it really cares about and which ones it doesn't.
Okay. I think one way of looking at this is a job first is injected under that. Say suppose it is still devotee we are talking about, we are going to vote. Obviously, certain stuff that we need. Because our constitution says so, it has to be GPG checked. It has to be LDAP checked. We have to extract how the person voted. We have to send an acknowledgement back, and that acknowledgement different ways, secret or not. And finally, the results have to be calculated. Every time a vote comes in, I calculate the results. So this list of tasks that need to be done for that, these are the requirements for the job. You can either think of them as global parameters, or you can say that by default, every job comes in with a certain set of requirements, and these are those. A job coming in from the male input end also has a mind parsing which comes first. So you might, each front end might want to add a pre-processing stage. So you, so that is, just like we have, there needs to be some order that doesn't depend on the model. So the first thing we do for votes is do a GPG check. Now, depending on how the ballot was injected, some other processing has to be done, mime processing or XML transition. But the GPG module doesn't have a prerequisite. It doesn't care. What it cares is that it is, it has got either a crypt text or plain text plus signature block somewhere that it can run on.
Right. And if you consider that prerequisite is the message yet in a format that GPG can deal with. And that, and you can just consider that to be a flag that is, that starts off as unset, but then, you know, some previous module that puts the message into the correct format that GPG knows what to do.
Yeah, the thing
sets
though,
that flag.
Okay. Is it, but in any case, now you've got a specific set of flags.
Well,
which might change from a job from
well,
what
you call them prerequisites, I call them flags. I think we're talking about
we're talking about things. It's just semantics now.
Yeah.
So does this sound like a good idea? Or is this something people would want to have?
Yeah, it sounds much more flexible.
I have just something about that. It's still about, I'm still thinking about the network question versus public question.
Okay.
I haven't read any questions anyway, so feel free to question. If you have this sequence of engines or modules or whatever, and they converge on this tiling module, then I think we should be able to have two different instances of the same module used for sending ACK messages. Because I think if you get a vote by Java,
so the way that is handled in the blackboard fashion is that every processor that processes a job takes it off the blackboard, modifies it, and that includes adding other requirements. Let me take an example of which is I think might be easier to understand. Transcriptions. This is a task in which a voice file comes in at one end. Somebody listens to the voice file, types in the text, and then there is somebody who checks it, proofreading. So I'm using this, but that's the, my last project was working on at a hospital trying to get the doctors to this and that, all kinds of requirements. So one of the things that happened was sometimes when you're listening to the voice file, you realize that the doctor, you thought it was about patient X, but the doctor is actually talking about some other patient, and now you don't have their address. So what, when you listen to the job, this person has to have the ability to say, wait a minute, you need to have an address check done on this. Wait a minute, I could not understand part of this. So could a proofreader who has more experience with this accent, could you take another look at the job? So the processing is changed in a blackboard pattern by the process. You can add more requirements onto the job. So that's why it's more flexible than a hard-coded pipeline, which is where it goes either one path or the other. So Jabber, if it comes in through the Jabber, there is a Jabber translation module. It will add something back that says that we need a Jabber app to be sent to such and such a place. So now the requirement goes along with the job, and then the Jabber app, you know, and this acknowledgement has prerequisites. You need to have all the checks done.
And
guess you could, so you could maybe, when you ingest it, you could start it out with some requirements. Like, let's say it comes in via Java, you would inject, it would be ingested with the Java requirements and the, you know, a bunch of requirements specific to the application, like voting.
Yeah.
And you would only remove, or you would only move a job, you would only report a job as finished once all its requirements have been satisfied.
Right.
And so then you could even sort of verify that everything has been done properly.
Well, presumably it would be finished. Just one more module that would...
They can just publish module.
Yeah.
The published module only runs when everything else has been done.
Could be interesting to have a scripted program, whatever, that can prove that every message that comes in goes out in here or here or there.
Okay. What static I was thinking, actually, what I was thinking of
static verification.
Right. What actually I was thinking about was right now when messages come in, the original email headers, you know, which they received, like they're all discarded as soon as I've done my processing. Because I don't need to carry them through. In fact, it would confuse the rest of the model. I was thinking, instead of specifying input and output forms, that I create, we think in terms of object, there is a job object. And various processing changes the job object, and you attach various things to the object itself. Now, when I say attach something to the object, all it means is you add a pointer to the metadata that this was the previous form in such a directory. Now, the next step has been done and the metadata points to a separate file in the other directory, or we can give a database reference. The backend is implementation defined. So when we are coding the thing, we can either say, so the concept I'm trying to do is, the job object has the metadata that points to all the processing that has been done, or which has not been done yet. And there was, hey, we can even do, you know, check this object into SVN, and every time somebody processes it, we do a SVN commit. That, so we can use SVN as a backend. I mean, I wouldn't do it for voting, all right? But if you are doing document processing using our framework and various things are being done to a document, then I can see using SVN as a backend is reasonable for the document.
These carrier pigeons as a backend.
You should do some research whether such a framework already exists. I'm sure there is.
I've been working on this medical transcription system, so we did a lot of research to see if something like Oracle says that they are willing to sell us a Blackboard pattern module for $1 million US per seat per year.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. I mean, all those, it does sound like a workflow with Qt, you know, kind of like Pico and all that stuff, and QCS and all that stuff.
Well, it is kind of, it is a workflow model. The Blackboard pattern is a workflow. But the Q implies, well, it is kind of like Q and not.
Well, in those kind of stuff, you just drop stuff in the queue, and the queue stores, and somebody guys says, okay, is there something in the queue for me? And you pick it up, okay, this is why
so
it's
so
not
well,
the
queue
is Blackboard.
The queue is ordered. The queue is ordered. If Blackboard is
not. Not in those, I mean, kind of tip code stuff, you have a queue, because it's kind of a communication device, and they call that a queue, but it's more like Blackboard. More like a lake. You drop things in the lake,
and
somebody comes and
picks
it up.
Well, that's the Blackboard.
So the idea is you have a single queue, but you have about a dozen different queue runners, some of which are just ignoring half the messages.
Yeah, well, but pipes in the queue that can, you know, suck stuff.
And then they reject messages. How does that work with multiple queues?
So when you question my mind, it's another loop.
The same way we do it now. There's a module that requires a tally. Okay, so the tally sheet is a separate object in this. The part of the processing of this is a side effect is that the tally sheet changes when you run the tally module on your job.
Yes, but I mean, if the jobs are stored not ordered, and both of my vendors arrive like within 2 seconds of each other, and they are processed in the wrong order.
Technically, your mail could have arrived in any order. You can't rely on email as being an ordered service.
Timestamp could be part of metadata for that job object.
Right. Well, there are two things. Right now, if you're sending to devotee two emails, devotee just arbitrarily takes the order in which the job was received. If something happened to your email and your first mail arrives later than your second email, you'll get the wrong vote right now. So we don't guarantee that the order in which you send the vote is the order in which they're processed.
Unless you get the act in between, I guess.
Well, you probably get the acts in the proper order. That's
yes. If once you get the act, you can send your next vote because that means it's been processed.
Yeah.
But that's what you have to do. The issue you might have with black box ideas, I was thinking, is that it may be very difficult to debug. Because right now, the way you have it is like different queues, and if something gets stuck in the queue, you know which queue is that, and which process is not handling that correctly. So you can go straight to the script and say, okay, this message, this script, this doesn't work, why it doesn't. But if you have a blackboard, you have a common school area, if things get stuck in there, it's going to be really difficult to debug.
Why something has. But every job that comes in can have a sequential ID. So if I see that,
unless they come in by two separate ways.
Even so, we can create a time span based ID system where we can state that you can always have a common semaphore which governs what ID is given to your job. We probably will have to, otherwise it will be too confusing if there are two jobs with the same ID. It will confuse the heck out of everything.
So
we have some kind of semaphore that no matter which way it comes in, it will get the ID, and the semaphore will make sure that messages coming in at the same time kind of get the same order of ID no matter which system they come in. We can still check. You look at the output, you can see that if 91, 92, 93, 94 have been done, but then you have got 96, 97, 98, you know there's something gone wrong with and that is how I check right now.
Again, you're enforcing a pipeline on the black box.
I'm not saying I'm forcing a pipeline. I'm just saying that I noticed that there is one thing stuck. And then I would come in an hour later, if I still find that thing stuck, then I investigate.
It is as easy to find a culprit there in that case?
Well, it will be easy because
you would know exactly which job it is.
Right.
You know the job.
You know which process, what stage of processing it was in. And then
maybe have something that no job needs the requirements for some reason, somebody put a requirement and nobody fits, and you have to debug, why doesn't anybody take this?
That is very easily checked at injection time. You put something on the blackboard, every processing module has to register this common plugin thing, right? Every plugin goes in and registers themselves to the framework, and then the framework runs them at the proper time. If you get a requirement and there is no registered plugin for it yet, you flag something for the admin that we have got an unknown requirement.
And I guess the framework will then catch the case of a. Would a plugin be able to tell the framework some list of prerequisites that it's going to be expecting of its job, so the framework can check that all of those prerequisites are possible to satisfy within the current configuration?
Static verification.
It would have to be a little bit more static than.
You do all this checking before you start accepting jobs.
Right.
But this you can. The blackboard also allows you to dynamically add requirements based on how you process this job.
Only if the requirements can be satisfied by something that's registered before.
No, the module wouldn't know what has been registered before. The module can add a requirement. Then it comes to the blackboard proper, and the blackboard says, whoa, you've just added a requirement that I don't know anything about. And then it fires off a message to my pager or something, and wakes me up, and I go investigate what the heck happened.
You say, I forgot to enable this other module that produces this.
Or there is a bug in this new fangled framework system and somebody screwed up. Yes.
And how, I don't see it possible, it's probably possible, but how could that handle multiple, kind of like multiple jobs that can run in parallel, like multiple notification mechanisms? It's not like that you can get a message by Jabber, but you might want a notification by Jabber and at the same time by email. Because Jabber, I mean, it might be lost for some reason, even if you're connected.
We do it the same way that we can do now. If you send two different words, the last word.
No, just one vote, multiple notification mechanisms. Because it's like you will get to a point where you say, notify this message. And how can it will make that convert into two jobs? Notify by email, notify by blah, blah, blah.
There are two separate jobs, right? You got a job came in by email.
Oh, you got only one job in, and you want two notifications.
Two notifications, okay.
Or three or whatever.
Or whatever. This is the configuration for your Blackboard. You can look, the metadata is always, presumably, if you've got all the information there in that message, or you've got some way of getting the information, like I get email from you, I need to know what the Jabber ID is. If I've got a module that can convert, can query an external database, and say, okay, such and such Debian login has such and such Jabber ID, then there can be a, when I'm setting up the vote, I can say that if we have Jabber information, also add on the requirement that the notification has to be set by Jabber. This is what I was talking about, that you add some default processing when you're setting up the vote statically. And then, if we don't have a Jabber ID for you, it will log, send a log saying, sorry, couldn't send a notification. If no notification could be sent, then it's important that it will send. You can install it. So, the advantage of all this is that we can, if I do the plugin architecture right, you can have all kinds of modules put in the pipeline that check whether things succeeded, whether such and such a notification. So you can say that send Jabber notification to everybody. By default.
So another thing, would this be flexible enough to make it reasonable to have different error paths? I mean, with the pipeline, I guess you have like many different places that are job connected to the system. If something goes wrong, then you go to somewhere. Or like with your current architecture, you have lots of different things that can go wrong.
And every
check could fail. And if it does, what happens to the job?
The first time that the check fails now, we log that thing. And as soon as we have got the error log for any code, no more processing is ever done.
So with the plugin business with the Blackboard pattern, I imagine what you have is that each module would have a way to take a job off, decide that it fails, and put it over into a different file instead.
No, you put it in the same file, but now you have modified the metadata to say that this job is failed. So no other module will pick up a failed job.
So nothing else will touch it, and then by the end of the vote, you just have this
pile. Oh, but no, there's one thing that will touch it. Okay. Yeah, we want to go eat, guys.
Okay. And an error module will touch it.
An error module will go and touch all these mails.
Well, how many of you can just remove the other requirements except for if you go to an error module?
Yeah.
So now the requirement is fair.
But either way, thank you, sir.
Trying to do a little project.